So I wanted to talk about little galleries, and I wanted to talk a little bit about my show, but I felt really stupid sitting here talking to the camera by myself. So I invited a really good friend of mine who does work in television, so kind of knows this better than I do, and I felt much more comfortable having a conversation with Michaela Pereira about little galleries. Michaela is a very good friend, and you might even know her from television. I don't know. I will leave that to you to figure out.
You're more comfortable being silly in front of me. That's basically what
Yeah, pretty much.
it
Pretty
is.
much.
So, can I ask you a little bit about little galleries?
I wish you would.
Okay. First of all, where did the name come from?
Well, I wanted a name. First of all, it's, in a custodian closet.
I'm sorry, what?
Yeah, it's in a custodian closet. We wanted to do something that rather than when somebody does a new project these days, it seems like everything is bigger and better and faster and more. And we just wanted to go small. We wanted to go
Okay.
small and personal and, one-on-one, the way art and beauty and you should experience one another.
So
So
that's where the little comes from.
That's one part of where the little comes from, is it's small. We wanted it to be personal, one-on-one. It's in a custodian closet, for God's sake. And LIL stands for Life is Light, which is the other part of what this is all about and what my photography website is called also.
Okay, so there's so many pieces of that that I want to talk about. Let's talk about, first of all, I mean, the custodial closet begs a question. We'll go there later. Bookmark that one. I'm curious, though, given the work that you do, the photography you do, and the digital world, I mean, look at the way, thank you for the invite into my very first hangout, by the way. Look at what
Yay,
you're doing
we did
right
it.
here. I'm surprised that you wanted to do, if you will, a brick and mortar show. Why did you decide to do that instead of maybe something in more of a digital realm?
Well, we are doing the digital realm with the website, but my voiceover manager, Stacy Stahl, who owns Creative Entertainment Management in Portland, in the Ford Building, she and I sort of cooked this up one night over dinner. We came up with this idea, and we thought, how cool. Obviously, we can do it with a website.
Right.
That's kind of a given. But nowadays, how many people are doing something brick and mortar where you actually can go, hear the voice, hear the music, see the work, feel it, be in a space that was designed just to stand there one-on-one and have this experience? And we just thought, how cool. And the other really cool thing is the guy who owns the building, the Ford Building, was so excited about it, he donated the space.
He did not.
Yeah, so it's
Well,
really.
it's not a big space, so let's not
Well,
oversell it.
this is true, but
What
he's.
else was going on in there?
Yeah, I know. Well, hey, the mops were having a
The
good
custodian's
time.
really angry at you, by
I'm just saying. But
the way.
there's an art gallery downstairs
Okay.
in the Ford Building on the first floor, and this is on the second floor, and so there is an art and an artistic mentality, in that building, which is just fantastic in and of itself. So, to have the custodian closet be part of that culture when it was so sadly outside of that, it now
Well,
feels part
okay,
of the
so now,
family.
was it you that suggested the idea of a closet, or was that the space that was available? Because I know I'm obsessing about this, but
I
I find
know.
it fascinating.
Well, it was available. There was another space we thought of, and it got rented like before we made up our mind, and we thought, oh, okay. But then Stacy's walking. She has two offices there, so she's walking back and forth between them. And she looks over one day and she thinks, that's just big enough.
Wow.
And how cool would it be? Reclaimed commercial space,
True.
nothing going to waste.
Right.
I
Okay,
love
so
it.
now let's talk about the light aspect, because the one thing that I do know about you is light plays a very important role in your world. And I mean your world, not just in your life, because you're more than just, this. How did you bring light into your work and then into this event and this showing?
Well, I mean, of course, there's all different levels of that answer. One of the things about photography to begin with is it's about light. We're chasing light. We're bouncing light, we're balancing shadow and light, and you know, without light there's no photography, so there's that. And photographers live for the light. I've also noticed that in my photography world, I seem to be treated to these amazing light events. The way the sun and the clouds and the, I love landscapes, that's like my favorite thing in the world, and it just seems like so often, people have actually commented on the fact that the heavens just sort of seem to open up for me on
they
a regular
really
basis. Yeah, it's kind of uncanny. So there's that. And then I just think that, you know, light and life just are one and the same, and let's live it.
Amen. Yeah. Amen to that. Yeah. Let's talk about the collaboration with other artists. There's other artists that are going to be part of Lil Galleries.
Yes.
Was it a sense of you being the curator? Because you sort of came up with the concept, correct me if I'm wrong, came up with the concept, wrote the narration, voiced it over, chose the photographs. So how did you work with them? Because artists, we know, they're very connected to their work.
Yeah. They really are. Well, first of all the artists in this, especially here at the beginning, we all met on Google Plus.
No way.
Yeah. None of us knew each other until Google Plus. And
really?
Google Plus has just been a phenomenon that actually they're studying all over the world now, particularly the photographers community, because something happened there where we came together and it just ignited into this, you know, this incredible community of people with like interests helping each other. I mean, somebody like has a bad, you know, when the economy was so bad, they had to sell their camera just to pay the rent. So everybody got together and pooled up and bought them a new camera.
How about that?
Health problems. Some gal was locked up in her house and was sick and nobody knew it and somebody figured it out. And I mean, people, you know, got money together for hospital bills, and I mean, it's just really been...
Can I interrupt for a second? Because it's so funny, because you and I both talked about the fact that one of the things people complain about the internet is that it's isolating people, that they're often there, they're in their rooms and closets alone, but you're really talking about a sense of community.
Absolutely. And there's photo walks now. They started in the States, and now they're starting to happen in Europe and other places where we're actually getting together and meeting each other. In addition, Hangouts, of course, was the huge breakthrough because we could talk face-to-face and meet each other that way. But the photo walks and the people driving to meet each other, there's now physical meetups. And, I mean, I've never seen anything like it. It's just phenomenal. So the artists that I chose in Little Galleries, I met there, and I know them all now, and I've hung out with them, and we spent time. One of them's, you know, going to visit at the house here pretty soon for you know, a few days, and we're all just a family now.
That's so great. Yeah. So then did you choose them based on their work or more based on their approach to life and their vision?
Yeah. I actually started off, you know, it started small because I thought this is too crazy of an idea to ask anybody on board, so I'll just do it.
Really?
Yeah. And so I start off working on my own stuff, and I'm like, okay, I'm bored. I'm bored of myself now. I don't want to do this by myself. I want to play. You know, if you're going to throw a party, you want people to come and play.
Sure.
So it being new and all, I had to, you know, talk to some rather forward-thinking people who were willing to just hand over their photographs to me to create, because I found the music, chose the music, wrote, narrated, chose the photographs and the order and the edit and the whole thing. I did everything, and they just said, go for it. So I chose, you know, friends who had that kind of mindset. But beyond that, I chose friends whose work is, because there's so many of my friends who are just amazing photographers, and I'm hoping eventually we have them all here. But to start with, I wanted a contrast. So Jaime Ibarra is got this incredible, he shoots women, but he makes fine art out of these photographs, and he's renowned all over the world. He's a huge star in Russia.
Really?
And other parts of Europe. I mean, he's huge. And very, very popular here in the U.S. as well. And Brian Matias Urbex, you know, the urban exploration, the broken down buildings, such a contrast. My work is more, I actually made my first show, Constructs to Freedom, be more or less my own little mission statement about this, about breakthroughs and about, you know, becoming all that you can be. And that whole statement. So there was the big landscape and the element of it. And then the last one, which is Ricardo Lagos, which you've seen. With
I have to tell you, that, yeah, it stuck yeah. with me. It brought me to tears. And I'm glad you brought that up, because I actually wanted to ask you about that. Specifically, the images paired with your narration was so incredibly impactful. I immediately had thoughts in my mind, everybody needs to see this, because it gives compassion to homeless people, to people that are forgotten, people are on the street. They should use this as a marketing tool for homeless shelters. I had big ideas come out of it, right. And it shows me how impactful that is.
Well, that's exactly what I want. You know, if I take little galleries, I'll come back to that in a second, but if I take little galleries as a whole, I'm at a point in my life where legacy is important.
Interesting.
Yeah, I mean, what do you stand for? What are you going to leave? What are you going to make people think about? You know, what are you, if you could do anything you wanted, what would it be? And so this is part of that. It's not all of it, but it is part of it. And, you know, as such, it's very close to my heart. So the idea of art, of beauty, of bringing beauty to people's lives, of doing it through these incredible photographs, which in and of themselves is quite an experience. But I know from my background as a figure skater and a, you know, singer and a musician and, a you know, all this stuff in my background, how powerful music is. And as a voiceover professional, I know how powerful the voice is, because the voice carries your entire spirit and soul, and it completely broadcasts you and your message in a way that people feel. Mm-hmm. So if you put the message with the visual, with the vibration of music, it becomes something unto itself, and it becomes something quite different than any one of those elements alone, which are all great.
So then let me ask you, so let's take a piece of work. It's different when it's not your work. It's one that, you know, and I wanted to ask you to contrast that, because when it's your photographs, because you were there when they were taken, the images captured, you worked on them, etc. But when it's somebody else's, that's an interpretation.
Yeah. And it was very interesting to show the show to each of the artists individually once I was done, because in every case, you know, well, there were a couple that had a little more experience with the voice part, and then Ricardo had never seen his you know, his photographs with voice and with music, and it was so different. Just the fact of it being different was kind of startling to him, so he had to watch it a couple times, and then he fell in love with it.
Oh, okay.
It totally changed his perception of his pieces. And he's going to do something else with them as well. You know, he's got a project, that they're a part of. But this was very different than anything he ever thought of doing. So,
and then,
effectively,
go ahead. I'm sorry.
That's all right.
I was going to say, so to that point, logistically, did you sit down and go with them through their portfolios, or did they sort of give you what they thought you might like? How did that work?
Well, I said, what did I say exactly? I said, just send me 20 photographs, basically. Well, I think Jaime was the first one. I said, send me a lot, because I'm not sure how many we're going to need. We want to make it, all the shows are 3 minutes-ish, because if people are just walking in on their way home, they can watch a couple of shows without their feet getting tired and, you know, take a breath and experience some beauty and some wonderfulness and then go on their way. So wanted the show small. So, you know, there was a little bit of figuring out how many images were optimal for that time slot. Mm-hmm. You know, so it depends. But I told them all to send me 20. And then I looked through them. And just sort of knowing them, knowing their work, I just let it speak to me. And then I find the music, because that's the part, that's the next part for me.
And does it jump out at you, or do you have to, like, try it out a couple of times and play it over in your head?
Well, you know, in Jaime's case, that's his music. He plays he plays classical flamenco guitar. So,
he's a triple threat.
Oh, God, he's amazing. So that was a given. And so to me, once I put the photos with the music, the story just went bink.
Really?
Yeah, and that was pretty much the way it was. Let me think now. Oh, yeah, that's the way it was with all of them. I knew the feeling of the music. Because, see, the thing about me is I take photographs, but even my photographs are completely scored.
Mm-hmm.
They're in a cinema. They're in the theater. I mean, I'm already in the theater, watching the film, hearing the music when I take
pictures. Trust me, I know you.
Yeah. I know.
I'm starting to hear the music myself, dear.
Is it the one saying this is over yet?
No. I'm just saying if to know this one, for the people that are watching our hangout, to know this woman is to understand that she isn't one who thinks small, which is so ironic to me. That's why I keep obsessing about this closet. It's so ironic that you would do something so powerful and impactful and such a gigantic concept on such a physically small scale. Do you see what I mean?
Well, yes, I do.
That's the only thing small about this project.
Yeah. Well, I mean, think about it. Who's ever done anything like this?
Nobody has. You're right.
That's my point. And, of course, it could go big. But, you know, when you first have an idea, you're like, well, this will be fun. And I don't know if anybody's going to like it. So what am I able and what am I able and willing, time and money-wise, to put into this? And, you know, what makes sense? So there was that, you know, honestly, empirically, to consider. So small made more sense on that because I funded this. This is you know, there is no revenue model for this.
You're the financier as well.
And the financier as well. So this is a project I wanted to do for me.
Right.
If it turned out to be more successful and wanted to get bigger, well, fine. We'll deal with that later. But right now, I just wanted to do this thing. I wanted to see it play. And so then the thing became, well, we could get a big space and blah, blah, blah. It involves more people. And I just got tired. So basically, so the idea of, you know, going small, because nobody does. Nobody goes small. Who goes small? But when you stand in front of that, we used an Apple Cinema display, which the quality is unbelievable. And, you know, it's 27 inches, so it's not huge. But the quality, it draws you in. We're so used to entertainment being shoved in our face.
Absolutely.
Coming this way, that to have something play out that invites you is intimate and different. And I just think that art, at some point in people's lives, should be experienced that way, as your own personal experience.
That's going to be the soundbite they run on the news, you know.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's talk about the end result and the experience. Who are you in your mind? Because your mind is a very powerful tool, my dear. In your mind, who do you see or hope are your target audience or the people that will consume this?
My, that's a good question.
Well, thank you very much.
Do you do this for a living?
I do.
Wow.
Because you just talked about, you know, people coming through the building on their way from work. It sounds like it could be a momentary escape for some. It also sounds like it could very much be a destination for others.
Yeah, that would be great. You know, when I first thought of it, my only thought at the time was just imagining being this person who maybe lives in the neighborhood. I mean, never mind the website, because you can come on the website and see it too, but I'm just talking about the in-person place. Maybe you're in the hood, or maybe you're going there to the coffee shop downstairs, which is fabulous, by the way. Maybe to see a little art. Maybe you've got, you know, half an hour before you go home, got to make dinner, do whatever, and you're just not ready to go there yet, or you just want to catch your breath. You know that feeling, that part of the day?
Boy, I do.
Yeah. And you just want a little break, and you just step in there, and you just go, ah. And maybe something about that makes you think you can do something that you thought maybe you couldn't, inspires you in some way, appreciate something. I just think, I just had this idea of it triggering people either to just rest and relax or be inspired or feel something. You know, I just think so often in our society we're so shut down because, you know, I just think we just live our lives either running from or running to or shutting down, or I don't know. We just stop feeling and hoping and knowing and expanding when that's what we need now more than ever. So if I could provide a moment in somebody's day that that happens, that was about as far as I got.
So then when it's, now that it's all complete and it's ready to be given to the world on June 1st, how do you feel about it?
Well, I feel really excited now. There were many times along the way that I was like, what am I doing?
What have I done? Whose idea was this anyway?
You heard me say that a few times along the way. I know whose idea was this. So now I feel really, really excited. We still have more to do. By the time, you know, people see this, it will have already been done. It'll be up and running. And it'll be a completion of something that has been in my heart and been in my head and in my being for a long time. So I'm excited, and I'm excited to find out what I feel afterwards, because it's, when you complete something, that's a thing unto itself. Mm-hmm. So I think I'm just really excited, and I can't wait to see what happens. I've released a little bit of it at this point, and the response has been good, so hopefully that will continue.
Well, it's your offering, and exactly. We're all thrilled and really excited to see it, too. I'm very, very proud of you. Oh,
thank you. I'm just,
I want to know where you go. What's that?
What you just said, it's an offering. I think more than anything, I'm just ready to offer it and let it go and release it.
Release it into the, I was going to say the atmosphere, but it's the cybersphere, the every sphere, it's everything. So where do you go from here, a little gallery, curator, owner, narrator, writer, photographer extraordinaire, Karen Hutton?
Well, you mean with little galleries, where do we go?
Yeah, what's, you know, you're not a girl whose vision just sort of stops at the end of the trail. After you get to that trailhead, you find a new path to go. So
that's true.
Just saying.
Well, part of our initial plan, because we wrote out the dream vision, kind of like a, well, we wrote it like a bit like a one-page business plan. Not that it was really ever a business. Noises, door slamming. Not that it was ever a business per se, but if this goes well and we love the process, and when it settles, we go, yeah, we could do this again. We have members of our extended family in other cities that are art friendly, and we may try and set up other installations.
Maybe. I love this idea.
And you know, the original, well, after getting it done the first time, which right now I'm just going to be happy to do that, it really was to see whether it could go into other art friendly cities to offer something similar, because we're going to keep adding an artist each month, so the roster is going to grow, and I think at some point become quite something.
I think it will be, and I think it's, I've recently fallen in love with Portland and the TV show Portlandia, and I think Portland's a fantastic place for it to have its debut.
Yes.
It seems like a city that embraces this kind of offering, as we keep saying.
Yeah, it totally does, and that's, you know, Stacy knew that, and I suspected it, but she knew it, and I think it's going to be, unique, which is always really good.
Well, we are thrilled and very proud of you. And when I say we, I talk about your community that know you, that work with you, that have worked with you, that have known you a long time, whether it's figure skating, acting, coaching, all of the amazing things you've done. Photography is just your next realm. I'm pleased as punch to be able to do this. It was so funny for those of you watching out there, is that we both were so nervous about this. We talk all the time on the phone. We have hour and a half conversations on the phone. And, you know, shoot, we've seen each other in all sorts of scenarios, and yet this was the one that kind of got us. So, Karen, I'm proud
thank
of you.
Thank you.
Thank you for letting me do this. This was a very cool experience. Google Plus
Hangout. This was monumental, because you were willing to do a Google Plus Hangout with me, because this project...
I'm a little bit of a Luddite, but I managed to get online.
So this project is such one from the heart, and the only person that I really wanted to talk about it with was you. So thank you for doing that.
Now, we need to go back and talk about this custodian, because I'm really concerned. Did we get him a portable outside the building? Because he's got mops and Swiffers.
You know what? I think he got his own
room.
What's
the guy to do? You know what I'm saying?
I think he got his own room. I think he got his own, like, entire downstairs, like, you know, garage space.
Wow, he's moving on up.
He moved up. We moved into his old digs.
You're going to bring a little Febreze. You're going to bring some candles. This woman is addicted to candles. Have some candles burning in there to get out the smell of Clorox.
There's no I painted it. We hung painted stuff. It? The place is, it's pimped out.
Well, mm-hmm. Little shag carpet.
Well, they wouldn't let us do anything to the floor, but we did hang a velvet curtain, and it's beautiful.
Velvet rope or?
No velvet rope.
Wristbands?
No, I didn't want anybody to get entangled up. It's We got the velvet curtain, and the color, you'll like the color on the walls, is called leather.
Oh, I remember you sent me a picture of the leather. I'd never heard of leather paint. I don't think I'm going to go to True Value and ask for that, because they might think I'm trying to be sassy.
Yeah. No. No, it's a whole other brand. They don't even carry it at Ace. It's very special. It's a very special brand.
Very special. They discontinued it.
Yeah, shortly after we used it. Like,
and
we're coming back.
We're out.
Awesome. Well, Michaela Pereira, thank you so much for doing this with me. I really appreciate it.
Delight.
Means so much. And on that note, I hope you all enjoyed hearing a little bit about Little Galleries, and I hope you really enjoy the shows.
Great. Woo, woo.